God raised him from the dead, and you shall be saved. But no one can confess Jesus as Lord unless it's by the Holy Spirit working out of him. Now there are, I'm reading the King James Version, kind of an amplified King James Version. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of administration, but it's the same Lord. There are diversities of operations, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the word of faith, the gifts of healing, the working of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. Now all of these work that one and the very same Spirit divided to every man severally as he will. In other words, it's all these gifts are given to every man as the Holy Spirit wills it. Father, I pray that you would give us your understanding of this passage of Scripture. We love you, Lord, and we praise your holy name. Amen. So what is a charismatic? Well, about 100 years ago, kind of for about 1900 years, somehow or another in the church through the Roman Catholic influence, through the influence of the Lutheran church and some different things, and the influence of the Baptist church, for a long time nobody really talked much about being charismatic. What did that mean? And then there was a revival that occurred, a legitimate revival, by the way, that occurred on Azusa Street. By the way, my grandparents were kind of caught up in that movement at that time back in the early 1900s. It's been about 100 years ago. And those folks that were caught up in that movement began to manifest the spiritual gifting. At least that's what they called it. Now, some of it was put on, some of it was not put on. It was a legitimate revival, however. Well, those folks that were caught up in that revival became the Pentecostal movement in the United States. Well, then the Pentecostal movement split into a bunch of different movements. You had the Pentecostals, and then you had the Assemblies of God, then you had the Four Square, then you had the Apostolic Creeds, and you had all of these different guys out there, but they all sprang out of that revival on Azusa Street. Well, Southern Baptists were so shocked that there could be anything in Christianity that they didn't have control of for about the last 100 years. They've kind of tried to stay away from the term charismatic because to them, charismatic was almost like a word that you didn't want to be called. So consequently, a lot of Southern Baptists have no idea what you're talking about when you call somebody charismatic. Now, if somebody is charismatic to the point that they try to show out with the gifts of Spirit, I call them charismaniac. But charismatic is a legitimate term, and I'll show you why. We're going to look first at these first four verses here that we just read through, that in the King James sounds like really weird, but it's really not. And we're going to look at these four verses here. And before we walk out of here today, everybody's going to know what a charismatic is. Everybody in here is going to know what a charismatic is. And you're going to be able to answer the question on whether or not you're a charismatic. I hope that you are. I'll tell you that right now. I hope that you are. First of all, look at verse 4. It says, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. All right, so right there is your clue right there. Now, the word diversities really means, in the Greek, different kinds. There are different kinds of gifts. It means spiritual gifts. The word gift, though, is interesting. Everybody here that's saved by grace through faith, raise your hand and say amen. If you're saved by grace through faith, say it. I'm saved by grace through faith. Say it. All right, what's the word for grace in the Greek? It's charis. C-H-A-R-I-S. Charis. So this word gift is charisma, M-A, the result of grace. Now, are you a charismatic? You betcha. Everybody who's saved by grace, say amen. Amen. The result of grace is the gifting of the Holy Spirit. It's as simple as that. So are you willing to give up what the Holy Spirit has given you freely? Are you willing to give that up? I'm not. In fact, you don't want me to give that up, because if you did, my sermons would get a whole lot more boring than they maybe already are. But it's through the gifting of the Holy Spirit that my sermons are anointed. Understand that. When you teach a Sunday school class, it's by the gifting of the Holy Spirit that you make a good point. It's charisma. The results of grace energema. Remember charisma, the result of grace? Energema means the result of energy. It means a product, something that is produced. So an operation is something that is produced. How? By the energy. That's what that word down there means. Work. That's the word energy. Energema is something that is produced by the energy of God. So therefore, every time that I preach a sermon, that is energema. That is something that is produced by the energy of God. Every time that you teach a Sunday school class, that is energema, something that is produced by the energy of God. Every time you go and reach out to the homeless, that is energema, a product, something that is produced by the energy of God. There is no sense, and it's a waste of time. Now listen to that, if you're listening, say amen. It is an absolute waste of time to go and do anything in the name of Jesus unless our efforts are energized by the Holy Spirit. But because the only time that anything productive, energema, productive will come out of it is only when it's energized by God. Now, I have preached now for 26 years, and most of the time, 95, 96% of the time when I get up here, I feel the power of God working in me as I preach. But there's been that 3 or 4% of the time that I've got up and preached sermons and I did not feel the power of God, and those are just the dry sermons. They may have been technically correct, but they were not energized by the power of God. They didn't produce anything because they were not energized by God. Unless our efforts are energized by God, you can be the best soloist that ever sang a song. You can be the best drummer that ever played a drum. You can be the best guitar player that ever played a guitar. But unless your efforts are energized by God, it will not produce anything eternal. And what we're all about, brothers and sisters, we're about the eternal. We're about producing things that last eternally. That's what we're about. Everything we do as believers is we're trying to produce things that will last eternally in the kingdom of God. Now let's go on. All right, that was a pretty cool one. So the way that would read in English, by the way, I've got a few copies of the sermon up here if you want to look at these words. There are different kinds of products as a result of God energizing us. All right, the next verse, verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to only a few. Is that what it says? No. It says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit. To do what? To profit. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit. In other words, and that word manifestation means the exhibition. And what does that mean? That means when you hear somebody preach and you're moved by their preaching, or you hear somebody teach and you're moved by their teaching, or somebody prays for you and you're moved by their prayer of you, that is the exhibition of the power of God. Not the individual's power, but that is the manifestation, that's the exhibition of the Holy Spirit working through that individual. But it says here that the Holy Spirit has been given to each one of us for profit. Now, it's important, I think, this is the way I see this verse. Some people would say that that's for personal profit. I'm not talking about earning money. I'm talking about that the gifts of the Spirit are given to us as individuals to build us up, to make us feel good, so we can have great experiences with God, and we can profit from that. I don't think that's what it means at all. The word profit there is some pharaohs. And you can get the clue there. The profit, what it means is to build up on a stack, to stack things up. Think about this. Peter calls the church a bunch of what? Living stones. And the church is being built one stone at a time. Who was the first living stone that accepted Jesus? It was Peter. And he was placed on the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. And the church has been building up ever since then as little stones growing up into a holy house. Some pharaohs, prophet. So listen now. If you're listening, say amen. The Holy Spirit was not given us to individually profit from the Spirit, although there's great profit from having the Spirit work through us. The Holy Spirit was given to us to do what? To build the church of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit was given to us to build the church of Jesus Christ. We all have different jobs to do in different ways, but the same Holy Spirit was given to each one of because he was near to Jerusalem, and because he thought that the king, that because they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. In other words, they thought that the kingdom would come and Jesus would not leave. They didn't understand he was going to go away for 2,000 years. He said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then to return. And he called his 10 servants and he delivered them 10 pounds. And he said unto them, occupy till I come. Now, obviously, the king is Jesus. Obviously, the far country is heaven. Obviously, servants are us. Everybody take your finger and say, it's us. Everybody say that, it's us. We got to get this, it's us. And what did the king say to his servants? Occupy till I come. Well, that sounds good. We can occupy a pew, we can occupy a church, we can occupy a community. You know, we can go to church once every 3 or 4 weeks, or maybe once every 2 weeks, that's plenty. We can give our money every once in a while. We can occupy till Jesus comes. That's not what it means. The word occupy is pragmatuo. And what that means is to turn a profit. In other words, the king is going to hold every one of his servants responsible for whether or not we turn a profit as one of his servants. Now, that's scary. That means that when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, yeah, we're going to be glad to see Jesus, but he's going to look at us and say, servant, did you turn a profit for me? Now, you can believe this or not believe this. You can look up the word yourself in a Hebrew Greek dictionary. You'll see it is pragmatio. And what it means to turn a profit. So Jesus told his servants, turn a profit until I return. Now, everything you say, why are we talking about this profit so much? And I thought we were talking about spiritual gifting. Everything that spiritual gifting is about is turning a profit for the kingdom of God. I don't care how much profit you got in the bank. I don't care how much profit you got in your house, how much you got in your car. How much profit are you turning for the kingdom of God? Well, I give my tithes. Great, that's what you're supposed to do. But how much profit are you turning for the kingdom of God? How much have you produced by the energy of God for the sake of the kingdom? Because all of us have an opportunity to produce something positive, to produce profit by the energy of God. We're all energized by God. All of us. And Jesus expects us to say, well, you're wrong. I've heard good sermons about this and that and the other. But I'm going to tell you the way I see this. We're the body of Christ. Amen? We're going around energized by the Holy Spirit, building the church of Jesus Christ in the world today. And as we go about doing different things, we encounter different challenges. For example, you might be, I told you, I'm not a healer. I'm not going to have any healing services. I'm not going to make it to TVN and people sending millions of dollars to do stuff. I'm not a healer. But I've prayed for people before, and they've been healed. Well, that's not by me, obviously. What is that by? That's by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's something that's produced by the energy of God. But I'm not a healer. But God is a healer. Amen? That means, brothers and sisters, not just through pastors, not just through elders, not just through deacons. If God calls you to go and visit somebody and calls you to pray for that individual, that person can be healed. If God wants it to happen, just as much through you as he can through me, through any believer. Why? I believe that all of these gifts of the Spirit are available to us as we go about doing what? Serving God. Paul manifested, he was an apostle. Yes, I understand he was an apostle. But if you look at Paul's history in the book of Acts, he went about and was in a lot of bad situations. And God always gave him what he needed spiritually in order to get the job done. I believe the Holy Spirit still works the same way. That when we go out, not knowing what maybe what's going to happen to us, you know, and as we go out to, even in the neighborhood, I believe the Holy Spirit goes with us, and whatever we need to get the job done, we get the job done. Look over at Ephesians chapter 3, just real quickly, so you can kind of see what I'm talking about here. It's really important that you understand this, because the key for today is not the fact that we all have been gifted by the Holy Spirit. The key today is as to whether or not we'll surrender to service. See, it says here in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1, it says, Paul's talking about himself and his ministry. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given to me toward you. What does that mean? That's Jesus told Paul, I'm going to send you not to the Jews, but to the Gentiles. And you're going to suffer many things for me. And then so what Paul is saying is, hey, I took that, I surrendered to that job that Jesus gave me. I've gone to the Gentiles, and I received God's dispensation of grace in order to accomplish what he called me to do. In other words, Paul doesn't itemize the gifts of the Spirit that he received. He received the whole package so that he could get the job done. I believe that the spiritual gift package is available to all of us. We don't get them all at one time, but we get what we need in order to get the job done if we're doing the ministry that Jesus has called us to do. Look at verse 6. And this is what he was preaching, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, partakers of his promise, the Holy Spirit, in Christ by the gospel, which I was made a minister, that's his ministry, according to the gift of grace, that spiritual gift, charisma, given unto me for the effectual working energy of his power. So Paul went out with the gifts of grace, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, energized by the Holy Spirit of God to do what God called him to do. Did you know that no matter who you are, no matter what you know how to do, or think you know how to do, or think you don't know how to do, that if God called you to do something, did you know that you can do it? See, a lot of believers don't really believe that. Not really. They don't really believe it. So let me ask you this question. How do I know what spiritual gifts Jesus has given to me? Maybe you don't believe that you get the whole package. So how do I know what spiritual gifts Jesus has given to me? And I wrote down three thoughts that I want you to take with you talking, but you know God has taken over because you start saying things to him that you probably wouldn't have thought about saying when God takes over. It's amazing to see what happens when God takes over. If you want God to take over your life, though, the first step you got to take is, okay, I surrender. I'll serve. And then when you take that first step, then God takes over. Some missionaries, in fact, every missionary I've ever met, tells me that the safest place for us to be is within the will of God, serving Him. in the church, Jesus gave some to be apostles. Those were all dead. He gave some to be prophets. Those were not like Daniel and those guys. These were guys that spoke the word of God before the word of God in the New Testament was written down. None of those guys left. He gave some to be evangelists. There's a lot of evangelists out there today that are called, God called evangelists. He gave some to be pastors. That's me. And he gave some to be teachers. That's also me. That's really what I am. I'm a preacher teacher. Why? This is who Jesus gave to the church. Now we're talking a little bit different. It's not what he wants out of the church. It's who he gave to the church. Why? Verse 12. For the perfecting or completion of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. See, for years and years and years, I served in a lot of different ways. And I surrendered. When I surrendered, I said, okay, I'll take on a little bit more responsibility. He called me to be a pastor, which I didn't really want to do. But that's what he called me to do, so I sucked it up, and that's what I did. All right, now my responsibility is this. This is my number one responsibility of everything that I did. My number one responsibility is to teach you and encourage you and to exhort you to go out and do the work of the ministry. And when I can, I will go with you and help you and show you how it's done. But I can't always do that. But the point of this sermon today is to try to challenge you to serve God. And then just to trust God in service and then watch the Holy Spirit work through your life. It's really that simple. And you've got deacons before you that are serving in all capacities in this church. You've got teachers here in this church that are serving and are very faithful in a lot of different capacities in this church. But I tell you right now, you know, there's a lot of, Deborah needs somebody in first, second, third grade to help her, but we also need somebody in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade. We've got some fourth, fifth, and sixth grade kids. My wife, Debbie, Sheree, and them, they just moved to California. But now Debbie has no substitute, Ron Helser, and is a tremendous help, by the way. But he's not really the teacher down there. Deb is the teacher. So now she has no substitute. So there needs to be somebody down there at least once a month that will give Debbie some relief. Debbie still will be there. Some guys don't realize this. Debbie teaches pre-K kids, okay? Did you know that she probably puts 5 or 6 hours into preparing for every Sunday? She probably puts more time in than I put in on my sermons because I preach a lot of these sermons. So she needs help there. In the nursery. Thank goodness we've got somebody that's willing to go in the nursery and serve, but we're having to pay her. We need somebody, we need a rotation of 4 or 5 women in here that'd be willing to once a month or so, once every 5 weeks to serve in the nursery. That'd be a really cool thing to do. I remember when Brother Henson came to the deacons back a long time ago when I was a deacon, wasn't a preacher yet. And Brother Henson came and says, hey, we need to spend $100,000 and improve our nursery facilities. And all the deacons said, you're crazy. He says, okay, I got this for you then. He says, let's just table that motion, and for the next 2 months, I'm going to expect every deacon to give me one Sunday in the nursery. And 2 months later, that passed by flying acclamation when all the deacons had to go serve in the nursery. Listen, you know, it's good that when you're out and you do things spontaneous for people, that's good. And that's important. And that's a beginning to serve. But you need to serve in your church. That's how you learn. And you make a lot of mistakes. But that's how you become faithful in what you do. You accept